Hello guys, welcome back. Myself Pushpendra Singh, and we are going to start with our NCERT classes. So this is your last class for social science, basically your part of your civics. Okay, and as you know that these classes are basically useful for those who are preparing for the civil services examination, right? And these classes are meant for covering your NCERT books one by one, right? And these classes are uploaded on the YouTube, so you can subscribe our channel on the YouTube, that is Future IAS, for these classes. And these lectures are uploaded on the YouTube on the day-to-day basis, so you can always subscribe and you can supplement your preparation with the help of these video classes. You should also study the NCERT books for better understanding, right? And these lectures will supplement you for your enhanced preparation, right, for the civil services examination. Fine. So let's begin with the lecture. Okay, so the next is basically the outcomes of democracy. Okay, now let us understand, as we have understood, the significance of the democracy, right? Now let us understand what are the outcomes of democracy, right? What are the main purpose of having the democratic country, right? Like for our country, India is also a democratic country. Okay, so what is the benefit? And what are the outcomes of having the democracy, right? As you know that India also set up the democracy at the grassroots level also, right? Democracy at the grassroots level, for example, as you know that we have set up the panchayats also, right? So panchayats basically a third tier which we have set up at the rural level as well as at the urban level also. So we have set up a three tier panchayati raj system at the rural level. And urban level, we have set up institution called municipalities, municipal corporation, municipal councils, right? So what we have done is we have set up the democratic framework at the grassroots level also. So we have institutionalized the democracy at the grassroots level also with the help of 73rd Constitutional Amendment Act and 74th Constitutional Amendment Act 1992. Okay. So the first is democracy produces accountable, responsible and the legitimate government. That is obviously because in the democracy, it is ruled by the people for the people, right? When you say it is ruled by the people for the people, that means you must understand we sent the representatives, right, to the parliament. That is also called representative form of democracy. Okay, that is also called indirect form of democracy. So democracy can be of two types. One is called indirect. Okay. Let us briefly understood that also. So indirect democracy, okay, and the second is basically a direct democracy. Okay, in the direct democracy, the people are directly involved. For example, in that we have adopted the referendums, right? We have adopted, you know, directly the people has the power to recall their representative or recall their leaders. So people have the power, right? They have the power in their hand directly. But what is in the indirect form of democracy, which we have also adopted, right, in which we have basically the procedure called elections, right, in which the representatives of the people, that are basically the member of parliament or member of legislative assemblies, that is called the MPs or MLAs, basically elected through the elections, isn't it? And through the elections, we send them to the legislative houses like parliament or state legislative assemblies. And they basically govern us on behalf of us. So that is, we select them, we chose them, and we send them to the parliament to govern us. So that is, that makes them accountable because we have also set up, you know, or we have made certain arrangement, right, in our constitution also, right, that which ensured that accountability of those representatives should be maintained, right? They also become responsive also, right? Whatever the policies they have brought, they are responsible for that. Otherwise, we have the power to remove them in the next elections. And moreover, we have set up in our constitution that a no confidence motion can also be passed against them, right? So they are under Article 73, right, of the constitution, which makes them, they are collectively responsible to the Lok Sabha, right, for their acts and omissions, right? Which means the Lok Sabha can pass a no confidence motion. The Lok Sabha can pass a no confidence motion, right, against the entire council of ministers, against the entire council of ministers, and at that point of the passage of this no confidence motion, the government is bound to resign, right? The government will fall. So the democracy is concerned with ensuring the people, that people have right to choose their leaders, their rulers, and they have control over the rulers. That was, I was explaining this point to you, right? And you must also understand that the it is possible the citizens also take participate in the decision making in the democracy, right? That is also one of the important aspect. The citizens directly participate, right? Here, and it is possible and it is necessary to participate in the decision making also, okay? And definitely in the democracy, since it is ruled by the people for the people, obviously whatever the decisions that you take, that is based on some procedures, that is based on norms. It is not taken arbitrarily one person, right? It is obviously based on the consensus, it is based on the norms, and is based on well-defined procedure, right? So it has that setup also. So it is based on the institutional development, right? And the citizens are also right to examine the process of decision making. For example, we have also set up the Right to Information Act. The Right to Information Act, as you already know, right? The Right to Information Act in 2005, which enabled the common citizen of this country to get the information from the government, right? On what basis they have taken the decision, right? What are the basis of their taking of their decisions? Everything the citizens has right to know, right? In that process, the citizens are able to understand the government machinery, and sometimes the citizens are also able to unearth some of the corrupt practices that are going on in the government, right? So that basically, you know, enforce the concept called transparency in the governmental functioning. Okay. And as you know that for the democracy, right, to produce the accountable, responsible, legitimate government. So for that purpose, we should have certain the precondition for that, right? Certain precondition in order to ensure that the government is accountable, responsive, or legitimate. First of all, there should be regular, free, and fair elections. That means the regular elections should be there, because if there is no regular election, right, that means a one party have some dominance over the political system, or one person have some of the autocratic tendencies. So regular elections is must. Second, the election should be free and fair. It does not matter whether regular election is happening or not, unless and until there is a free and fair election. So free and fair election would ensure that the power goes to that person or that political party who have scored well in the outcome of elections, rather than it should not be based on certain, you know, biased criteria, rather it should be based on the rational criteria of free and fair elections, right? The election should not be rigged, right? It should be free, it should be open, right? Every person who is having the 18 years and above, based on the universal adult franchise, should be able to participate in the election, right? There should not be the money power, muscle power, all sort of in the elections, right? Then only the elections would be made free and fair, right? Then open public debate on the major policies and legislation. That is the must, because if you pass the legislations without discussions, without debate in the houses, what will be the outcome? It is not based on the consensus, rather it is based on the, you know, the single-sided criteria. It is based on simply by forcing, you are just forcing the bill to get passed in the parliament, right? So there should be open debate. The bill should be placed in the public domain and on the websites, right? On the concerned ministry to have, you know, some sort of opinions from the public, from the civil society, from the NGOs, and then only the legislation should be passed. Then the citizen right to be informed about the government policies, that is also there. The citizen should have the right to get informed about the government policies, what the government is trying to make, what policies government are interesting, whether these policies are useful for the public or not, whether it is, you know, sometimes the policies which are brought by the government may have some linkages with the political party itself. The political party may get benefited out of policies then rather than the normal public. So we should also ensure that such policy should be for the public, right? It should benefit for the public rather than a particular concern over a particular political party or particular reason, right? A government should be free from the corruption. That is the most important. Right, any corruption or any corrupt practices definitely would jeopardize, would tarnish the government, right, the machinery. So definitely the corruption, the government should be free from the corruption, and for that purpose an institution should be set up for bringing, you know, certain corrupt practices in the departments, right? We have also set up, say, Central Vigilance Commission, so we have vigilance officers in the department to check any sort of a corrupt practices. We have law enforcement agencies. We have also made, you know, the corruption related laws, statutes, which is passed by the parliament to check all such corrupt practices in the department. All right. So that are very, very important for checking any corrupt practices in the department. Right. So let us understand what are the gross outcomes that we have. So obviously, the democracy is better form of the government when you compare with another form of government. For example, if you see the dictatorship, for example, it was there in the Egypt, it was there in many Arab worlds, in the Muslim countries, where almost a dictatorial type of tendencies are there. Okay, one person is ruling the country for more than 25 years, more than 30 years continuously. Okay, that is a form of dictatorship, right? There is no grassroots level democracy. No people can participate in that particular process. So obviously, democracy is broad-based. Democracy is based on consensus. It's ruled by the people for the people. People are directly involved in the outcomes of the democracy. So there is no alternative to the democracy, right? If the democracy is best form of the government. So democracy can be of two types. You can also understand the presidential form. Okay, the presidential form, and the democratic government can be of presidential form or the parliamentary form. Okay, in the parliamentary form, for example, we have adopted in India, that is the parliamentary form, in which we have the Lok Sabha, Raj Sabha, and in the parliament we have also the president. So president is also a part of the parliament, because the parliament consisting of Lok Sabha, Raj Sabha and the president. But in the presidential form, there are only Congress. The Congress consisting of the Lok, that is upper house, right? That is basically upper house, and that is also lower house. The president is not considered as an integral part of Congress in the presidency system. And moreover, in the parliamentary system, that works based on the principle of responsibility. That means the Council of Ministers are responsible to the Lok Sabha. But in the presidential system, right, the president is not answerable to the Congress. Second, they are not answerable, so they are not accountable also. Moreover, in the parliamentary system, the executive sit along with the legislative wing. For example, in the parliamentary system in India, Home Minister, Defense Minister, Finance Minister, they all sit in the parliament. But in the presidential form of the system, the ministers never sit in the Congress. They never go. In the presidential system, they are called basically, you know, secretaries, and secretaries never go and never sit inside the Congress, so they are independent of the Congress. Okay, and in the presidential system, the secretaries are only responsible to the president, and president has power to remove them. But in the parliamentary system, you must understand, right, the Council of Ministers, which are also similar of the secretaries which are existed in the USA, the Council of Ministers in the parliamentary system in India are responsible for their acts and omissions, the Lok Sabha, not to the Prime Minister. So they are responsible to the Lok Sabha, and the Lok Sabha has the power to remove any of these councils, to remove whole of Council of Ministers by passing a no confidence motion. So democracy is better form of the government, definitely, when you compare with others. Okay, so what we felt that democracy is much better because it promotes equality among the citizens, right? For example, in the democracy, as I told you that, right, it is possible to give the representation, right, to the diverse sections of the society, right? For example, in the democracy, that you have seen that many ministers came from the diverse background, say from SC community, from ST community, from backward classes, right, from economically backward classes. So it promotes definitely equality among the citizens, because the broad-based representation is possible in the democracy. Okay, that in enhance the dignity of the individual. Definitely, if you provide the representation to the weaker sections of the society, say for women, for the minorities, for the SC, for the ST, definitely there it will enhance the dignity of individual, because now they were able to participate directly in the democratic form of the government. They are able to vacate their own, that whatever the problems they have, and they are able to, right, participate in direct decision making. So the improve the quality of the decision making, definitely, because in the democracy, the decisions are based on the consensus. It is broad based. The people are directly involved. Diverse sections have been given representation. So definitely decision making is much, much better than another form of government. It provides a method to resolve the conflict, definitely, because it is broad-based. So every people, whatever they are there on the board, they will have to deduce some other method, which is much better, which is much broad, which is much consensusly deduced. And it is based on definitely, you know, open and broad-based criteria. And definitely that will help in resolving the conflict. It is not imposed on certain people or certain group of people, right? And it also allowed the room to correct the mistakes also, definitely. So it will have certain, you know, the well-defined features to correct, you know, the mistake that have been committed. Okay. And when we have the dilemma, for example, what to choose. So democracy is good alternative. It is also seen good in principles, right? There is no other alternative to the democracy when you have to give the greater, you know, representation to the people in that respect. Okay. Now you have to think a lot that what outcomes of the democracy should be there, what we are trying to have the outcomes from the democracy. If you have set up just democracy, not at the grassroots level, the outcomes may not be there, right? So democracy should be established and it should be allowed to function, right? Then only the outcomes of the democracy would be best. Okay. So, you know, so obviously the democracy often puts us, you know, basically that we address all sort of the socio-economic and political problems, right, which are vested in every sections of the world, right? So all sort of the socio-economic problems and political problems can be resolved through the democracy. So the first step towards, you know, to achieving the outcomes of the democracy, right, is to recognize, right, the democracy should be existed at the grassroots level, right? It should be allowed to function. The representative should be allowed to function independently. And as I told you, that certain preconditions, like there should not be corruptions at the grassroots level, there should be free and fair elections, there should be regular elections, right? There should be some mechanisms to be put in the place, right? And it should also help in, say, another aspect, say, economic growth and the development, because the democracy definitely, you can basically, you know, quantify the outcomes of the democracy based on the economic growth and the development that is brought with the help of the ideals of democracy. For example, you know, if the democratic government or if the democratic functioning do not achieve the higher economic growth, definitely it will question mark on the cardinal principles of the democracy. But that alone cannot be a reason to reject the democracy, because you must understand, sometime what happens is the economic development, when you say, you know, sometime when you say in the countries where the dictatorship exists or where the democracies exist, right, sometime the differences between them or in terms of their rates of economic development is negligible, right? So we cannot say that democracy is guaranteed to the economic development, but definitely we can expect that the democracy is much better than the dictatorship in this respect, right? And dictatorship basically bring a lot of other problems to the sections of the society which do not support the dictatorial tendencies. And definitely there is very less number of freedoms available, fundamental rights available to the people, especially in the dictatorship, right? But in the democracy, the fundamental rights which are available to the people, right? The freedom which are available to the people, to the common citizen, right? The ability of the citizenship or ability of the persons to participate in the elections will be much more, right? They will have no fear of anyone, right? They can openly express their the problems, right? And they have right to participate in the decision making also. So it will be more broad based, it will be more consensusly, and definitely over the longer period of the time, the economic growth will be achieved. Okay, next, you can also find out the outcome maybe in terms of reduction of inequalities and the poverty, right? So, you know, generally we think that the democracy would bring or would reduce the poverty or, you know, would reduce the inequality. For example, in India, right, almost more than 70 years have gone, right? Inequality still persists, okay? And the poverty are still there, around 21% of the population of India basically lives below poverty line as per the Tendulkar committee report. Okay, so you know, you must understand, a very small number of people right? They have, almost 90% of the wealth, right? So roughly you can say 10% of the people have 90% of the wealth accumulation, top 10%, right? So that is disproportionate share of the wealth and the income that are vested with the people. So where is the outcome? Where is the equality in the society, right? So it should be based on, see, democracy do not appear to be successful in reduction of economic inequality in the actual life. As we have seen, the government is openly supporting, the industrialist or certain, the rich people for their own benefit, right? So for that purpose, it is not seen very successful in reduction of the economic inequalities, generally what we have seen, okay? Not only in the India, but also in the US, if you go there, this is a similar feature or this is a similar phenomena. The rich people basically have the disproportionate share of the income, the disproportionate share of the wealth, right? Which is also the most problematic part of the democratic functioning, right? So again, the equality in terms of, in terms of the share of the wealth and incomes and in reduction of the poverty is most important aspect of any socio-economic development of any society. Okay, then accommodation of social diversity. So definitely the democracy would provide you a platform where you can have accommodation or you can accommodate the diversity of the society, where you can give them a platform to where they can come, they can stand, they can put their demands and right, and they can achieve their certain objectives, right? So obviously it is the fair expectation that democracy would provide you the harmonious social life, right? Where every section of the society will have the equal say, right? And it is having the ability to handle the social differences, that divisions which are existed and conflict which are there. But is that really is there? For example, in our country, which is also a democratic country, we have problems in our society. For example, we have caste-related problems still existing. It is deeply rooted. Casteism, right? Still there after 70 years of the independence and after abolition of the untouchability under Article 70, still casteism is there. Communalism is still are there, right? As you know that, regionalism, right? This is another, right? So different other, divisions are there in the society, right? We have conflicts, we have Hindu-Muslim rights, we have communal rights, right? So all such things are there, okay? So these things basically, gives us, the questionable marks on the outcomes of the democracy, right? How come the casteism is still existent in our country? Because it is deeply rooted in our society. The society itself do not want to lose the grip of the casteism from them, right? So if we do not accept from our heart that these are all, all people are equal, right? They have equal, they should have equal say in the status, in the opportunities. Until then, we cannot achieve the equality in the society, right? And two conditions in order to achieve the outcome, right? First of all, it is necessary to understand that democracy is not simple rule, but by the majority opinion, right? So first of all, it should understood that it should be based on the majority opinion, right? And It is also necessary that rule by the majority does not become a rule by the majority community, right? So first of all, for example, in India, the Hindu is basically consisting the majority community. Around 83% of the population or 81% of the population belongs to Hindu, okay? So the majority rule, when we say the majority rule does not mean the majority community rule. The majority means it should be based on the majority opinion. That majority opinion encompasses the diverse sections, be it a Hindu, Muslim, different caste. So it is based on the consensus, it is based on the majority opinion. That should not be misunderstood with the majority community rule, right? Which is based on the religion, caste or linguistic group or maybe particular caste, right? Should not be understood with that. Then only we can ensure that every other section will have the legitimacy in the decision making, right? They can have the proper say in the democratic functioning of the government, right? Then only we can achieve all objectives which are enshrined in our constitution. Okay, now two conditions which are necessary for the democracy to achieve this harmonious society, right? First of all, the democracy should fulfill the following two conditions in order to achieve the harmonious social life. So first of all, we must understand the majority and the minority opinions are not permanent, right? And as I told you that the democracy is not simply ruled by the majority opinion, right? And the majority needs to work with the minority so that the majority should be accommodative, right? It should understand the diverse demands, right, which are there with respect to the minority, right? So the government should be function in such a way that it should be accommodative, it should be retrospect, it should be based on the proactiveness, it should be based on the sensitive demands or sensitive needs of the minority, right? It should be more accommodative, right? It should be more conciliative, right? So that every section of the society feel free that they are functioning, they are participating in the government, they should not be neglected, right? If they feel neglected, if they feel cheated, if they feel such type of feelings will be there, that may promote further disharmony in the society, and that will produce lot of violence also in the society. So everything should be there properly, and it should be looks to the function that they are also participating, right? Their views are also listened. They should not be felt cheated. They should not be felt in such a way that their views are not even taken by the government. They are felt cheated. So sometimes that may also produce the violence, and it may also produce counterproductive in the longer run. Okay. And the rule by the majority, as I've explained you, does not become the rule by the majority community, right? If that rule of the majority become the rule by the majority community, definitely it will be counterproductive, because the minority community, which is based on the race, religion, right, they may feel cheated, right? They have not given enough representation, they have not given enough room to resolve their problems, right? They should be given all other representation also, right? And the democracy remains the democracy so that every section has a chance of being in the majority at the same point of the time. So that is what I said, that there should be representation from every section of the society in the government formation, right? So every section should have the chance of being in the majority. So they should have, right, in the majority government, when I say it should not be based on the majority community, but the majority government, it means the majority should have every section of the society. That means that is cross-cutting of religious, caste, race, every section will have the participation in the government formation, right? No individual should be deviated from participating in the democracy, right? Either which is based on the religion, which is based on the caste, which is based on the community, creed, or any such factors, right? If the person felt that the government is basically discriminating the people based on the religion, caste, or community, they felt cheated, right? And definitely over the period of the time, their vengeance, right? Or they feel cheated, and over the period of the time, that may also produce counterproductive, that may promote the violence in the region. And in the acute chances, or in the most extreme cases, they may also demand the separation from the Indian Union. Sometime that may happen, that all other the secessionist tendencies which are there in terms of the demand for the separate statehood, in terms of demand for separate, the region based on the linguistic, based on the regional criteria, it is based on this, the sense or the feel of cutting out from the mainstream society, that they are not able to get the participation which is required in the democratic functioning of the government. So all such things are very much important in order to feel the people that they are also one among the stakeholders to participate in the democratic functioning of the government. Then only the people will be able to give their full in the democratic functioning of the government formation. All right, let's move. That is, understand the outcomes of the democracy. So definitely the certain things that democracy must provide in order to achieve certain directives or certain objectives, right? So in the democracy, people have the right to choose their rulers, and the people will have control over them. So here, rulers, you must understand, it should not be misunderstood with some ruler which was existed, right, before our independence. Here rulers means their representatives. Okay, so here the representatives means all other, your MPs MLAs here in the modern text, in the modern context, their representative should be understood with their rulers, right? So here the people should have the right to choose their rulers, right? So that should be through the free and fair elections. It should be based on certain rational criteria. It should be based on, you know, the institutional setup, right? And people should have also control over them, right? And whenever possible and necessary, should citizens should be able to participate in the decision making that affects all. So definitely we should also deduce certain mechanisms that the people should be able to participate in the decision making, right, which affect the people the most. Because if you just simply make the decisions, right, which are affecting the people without concerning about the people, without taking the people on the board or on the decision making, right, definitely the people will feel cheated that who are you to take the decision on behalf of us, right? So you should take our opinion before taking the final decision, right? So it is right to expect that democracy is to produce a government that follows the procedure and the accountability to the people. So that is why our democratic framework is also like that, right? They are based on the accountability, they're based on the principles of transparency, right? They will have the well-defined procedures, institutional setup, right? And definitely the democratic government develops the mechanisms for the citizens, that is the regular free and fair elections, open public debate that should be there, the right to information, right, about the government and their functioning should also be there with the people. Okay, the democracy is better form of the government than others. Okay, that is also quite obviously. So it is based on the criteria, the democracy is considered the better because the decisions which are acceptable to the people are more effective. And the democracy would definitely provide an avenue or the platform for such the decisions which are much broad based, which are acceptable to the people, which are consensually oriented, and the citizens has right and means to examine the process of decision making in that process, right? Definitely the whatever the decision the government is taking, that is based on the transparency, that is the government should be accountable for that also. Okay, and the democratic government is legitimate, right? That should be, you know, based on some free and fair elections. The independent body like Election Commission of India should be there to conduct the regular elections, right? Which should be able to, provide the right chances to every section of the society to participate in the electoral process. Okay, then there is also inability of the democracy to achieve the higher economic growth. Right, definitely, which is a cause of the worry. For example, in India, we are not able to achieve the higher economic growth despite of having the democracy since last, 30 years, or sorry, since last more than 70 years, right? And we are also not able to achieve, the social harmony, right? There are a lot of conflicts, right? The decisions and the differences which are already there in the democratic design, but definitely we have achieved certain positive aspects also, right? And the democracy has strengthened the claims of the disadvantaged and discriminated caste for equal status and the equal opportunity. For example, what we have given is reservation. Okay, so we have given the reservation to SC, ST community, especially in the Lok Sabha seats, in the basically state legislative assemblies. Okay, in the legislative assembly, we have also given the reservation to the jobs, right, in the educational institutions. We have given, right? So all other other institutional mechanisms we have set up to give the greater representation to the weaker sections of the society. Even we have given the representation to the women also, right? For example, 30%, at least 33% of the seats are reserved for the women in the panchayats. Now many states like Bihar have reserved 50% of the seats for the women specifically in the panchayats. So many institutional the mechanisms have been set up to give the greater representation to the weaker sections of the society, to the different castes that were considered untouchable, right? For example, SC, ST's community and other backward classes also. Okay, so dignity and the freedom of the citizens are best guaranteed in the democracy. So first of all, dignity of the woman, let us understand. Right, so definitely we have given the more representation to the women. Specifically, adequate attention have been given to the elected representatives. For example, at the grassroots level, at the Panchayati Raj system, we have almost 1/3 of the seats reserved for the women, specifically in the panchayats. Right, and we have given the fair proportion to the women in the elected bodies, but now still, a bill was passed in 2010, the woman reservation related bill in the Lok Sabha and the Raj Sabha, in the legislative bodies, right? But that bill was still not passed basically in the Lok Sabha. So the bill is still pending, but you must understand what we have given is 1/3 of the seats have been reserved to the women, specifically in the panchayats, that we have achieved, right, some goal regarding the greater representation of the women. But still the woman reservation bill, which is still pending in the Lok Sabha, which have just passed in 2010 in the Raj Sabha, which ensured 33% of the reservation to the women in the parliament and the state legislative bodies, which required to be passed, right, and then only we can ensure the greater representation of the women in basically Lok Sabha, Raj Sabha, as well as other state legislative assemblies. Okay, so democracy has strengthened the claim of disadvantage in the discriminated caste that we have seen just now. So democracy provides basically an avenue that the political parties basically usually take care of their representatives of the different castes and the tribes. We find the place, for example, in the BSP, right? They give the representation to the SC community, ST community, minorities, the Baidar backward community. In the Samajwadi party, they give representation to the Yadavs, right? For example, other backward caste, right? And for example, in the BJP, they generally give the representation to the upper caste. So we have the caste-based politics also, right? We have the caste-based politics also, but definitely the representatives of different castes and tribes also find the place in the basically distribution of the tickets. Okay, and some political parties used to favor some caste, right? That is based on, the BJP used to favor, different caste based on the upper caste. The BSP used to favor the caste which are belongs to, the basically SCSTs, and they are basically the weaker sections of the society, like minorities and OBCs. Similar case in other political parties also. So democracy definitely provides the equal status and the opportunities to all castes, right, in our country in that respect. Okay, so democracy transforms the people from the status of the objects to the citizen, right? So definitely the democracy will provide a platform that people will have the right to choose their rulers. Again, you must understand these rulers are not that ruler that was there. They are called representatives now. Okay, so the people have right to choose their representatives, like MPs, MLAs, right? So corresponding the PMs and CMs also, right? So all such things are required, and people will have their control over their representatives also, right? And the citizens will have the right to examine the process of the decision making. This is the most important, right? In the transparency in October 2005, the Right to Information Act have already been passed, right? Which ensured that the citizens should get the information about the functioning of the government department, right? On what basis the government basically takes the decisions, right? Which are based on either, the rational criteria, which are based on, some sort of a corrupt practices. So the corrupt practice is also able to unearth because of this Right to Information Act. And many such, the vigilant groups and vigilant peoples are basically got murdered because of this Right to Information Act, because they were able to disclose some of the corrupt practices which were there with the government departments also. Okay, now let us understand briefly the challenges of the democracy, right? Challenges, what we are finding is basically difficulty that carries with the opportunity for the progress, that is the functioning of the democracy. So what we have is basically the three types of challenges. First is foundation challenges, the challenges of the expansion, and the challenges of deepening of the democracy. Let us understand one by one. So first is foundational challenge. What is foundational challenge, right? That is any sort of a society, right, of making the transition to the democracy, right, and institutionalizing the democratic government. That is the most important challenge, right, for any society, right? If they are transiting from, say, from autocratic ruler to the democratic form of the government, that transition is very important, right? So transition to the democracy, setting up of this democratic ideals, right, their aspirations, their institutions, is most important challenge that we are facing, right, in the world. The second challenge is challenge of expansion, right? So what is expansion is basically you should apply the principles of democratic functioning of the government, right, across all the regions, right, irrespective of caste, creed, religion, right, across different social groups, different institutions, So applying of the uniformity of those basic principles of democratic government, that is the another challenge, because some society may not accept the democratic principle, that they said that no, we govern with our own rules and regulation, why should we adopt this democratic form of the government? So that is the challenge to accept. So even in the democratic setup, what we have set up, many societies still resist, right, some of the the basic principles of the democratic government. So that should be uniformly applicable to across the regions, across the social groups, across various institutions. That is the another challenge, that is also known as challenge of expansion. And the third challenge is basically deepening of democracy, right, that is strengthening of already existing institutions that are there, the strengthening of the practices with respect to the democracy, that is the another challenge what we are facing. So deepening of the democracy, what we have done also through 73rd and 74th Constitutional Amendment Act, what we have deepened our democracy. We have set up the grassroots decentralization, right, the grassroots decentralization that we have done, right. So what we have set up is by 73rd and 74th Constitutional Amendment Act 1992, we have set up the democratic decentralization. That process is called democratic decentralization. Okay. And what we have done is basically we have set up the Panchayati Raj system. We have recognized them as a constitution. We have given them a constitutional recognition for that purpose. Okay. For that purpose, we also need a political reforms. Right, so different political reforms are needed, right, to overcoming various challenges, right. So these are called political reforms or democratic reforms, right. So definitely challenges which are not similar to every country, there are different challenges to the different democratic form of the governments, right. So certain countries are facing foundational challenges, some countries are facing basically expansion challenges, some countries are facing basically the deepening challenges, right. So, some countries are basically face the challenges of bringing down the existing non-democratic design. That means in some countries, for example, if autocratic ruler are there, right, the government is run by the military, right. So going away from the military rule of and then moving towards the democratic function, that is another challenge, right. But some countries are making great effort to establish the sovereign and the functional state, which is based on the democratic criteria. Okay. The challenges which are faced, as I told you, that foundational challenge, which is basically the transition to the democracy, that is institutionalizing of the democratic form of the government, right, from existing non-democratic design to basically the democratic design, keeping the military rule away, right, keeping the autocratic rulers away, keeping all sort of a autocratic form of the behavior regarding the democratic function should be away, and establishing the sovereign and the functional state, which is based on the universal function, universal principles of democracy. Then the challenges of the expansion that I've explained to you just now, it is based on, you know, the principles of democratic functioning should be uniformly applicable across all the regions, across all the social groups, and across various institutions. And it should not be based on any discriminatory criteria, right? It should be universally applicable so that the people should adopt them, right, in a uniform way. They should have the greater sense of the participation in the democratic functioning, and this will ensure the greater power to the grassroots table, to the local government, right. And we should also extend those powers which are given to the local government, right. And that should also include, right, the representation from the weaker sections of the society, like women, minority groups, as well as other groups like scheduled caste, scheduled tribe, backward classes in the functioning of the government, right. And India and US basically faces this type of challenges of the expansion in their countries. The challenges of the deepening of the democracy that we have seen is basically in terms of what we have set up, what we practice. So deepen of all sorts of institutions, deepening of all sort of a basic cardinal principles which are based on the democratic function. So we should also adopt certain type of practices that basically deepens those existing institutions and the practices, right. Strengthening, we should adopt other measures that should strengthen further those institutions. Definitely not without the people's participation, but we need the greater people participation, right? Then only that institution will be, will be strengthened more, right? And definitely we should aim at bringing down the control and influence of the rich, right? The rich people and the more influential people should not control the government, right? And it should be based on, the broad consensus should be based on the every section of the population should basically, you know, should basically part of the democratic functioning of the government. It should not be based on some irrational criteria. It should not be based on one-sided criteria. Rather, it should be based on, you know, the uniformly applicable rules which are equally applicable to every sections of the society, irrespective of caste, creed, gender, sex, or racial criteria. And the government should not be controlled by any particular person or any particular, you know, a strata or any particular region, and the rich influence on the government functioning should be removed out. Okay, so now let us understand the broad guidelines for the political reforms. What are the broad guidelines? So first of all, the legal constitutional challenges that we are facing, right? You cannot overcome simply. So what we need basically the democratic reforms or the political reforms in that process. So that are basically carried out by the political activists. Different political activists, they basically put different type of campaigns, like, you know, the propaganda, right, the awareness campaigns, right, you know, disclosing all of the corrupt practices, right, going to, you know, to the different sections, bringing them to the main platforms, right, going and giving them representations, right. Even the parties are also, they should also be reformed based on their internal democracy, how they are functioning. They should not be controlled by any particular person, right, in terms of decision making. The decision should be based on the broad based, and it should be based on the consensus. In the yesterday's class, what we have seen, the movements, we have seen the Nepal, we have seen also in the Bolivia, right? So we have seen these two movements basically to strengthen, right, the democratic functioning, right? And we should also need the politically conscious citizens in order to actively participate in the decision making. Okay, so for that purpose, we should also be having the legal changes must be carefully look at what result we want from the politics. Okay, so if we generally simply ban on something, that may be a counterproductive, right? For example, if you just simply ban the people who have the two children from contesting the panchayat elections, sometime, you know, the poor people or the people who have lesser number of resources, they feel marginalized, they feel cheated. So first of all, we should make them aware, and we should give them some time in order to implement certain type of harsh decisions on the poor people, right? And this basically results sometime in the denial of the government democratic opportunity that are basically given to the poor people. That was the very basis of the democracy. If you just cut out those people from the democratic, you know, functioning, from participation in the democracy, how will they able to participate? So definitely we must empower them, we must give them enough, you know, room to change. We should make them aware, right, in terms of family planning and other aspects. Then only we should adopt certain type of harsh measure. So best law, who can empower the people who carry out the democratic reforms, right? For example, the best law is Right to Information Act, right, which may be a watchdog of the democracy by controlling corruptions. So we should adopt certain types of other laws which can deepen the institutional functioning of the democratic government, and rather it should not be based on any harsh criteria, right? And definitely the democratic reforms are to be brought about through the political parties, because political parties are basically governing institutions. They are the most important institution in any democracy. They should be able to, first of all, make sure that their own functioning of a political party should be broad based, right? They should internalize the functioning of the democracy within the political party functioning, right? For example, any party, if you see, right, the party decisions are taken by the most influential person. I don't want to name those political parties. You can easily understand only one or two or three persons basically take most of the decisions in every political party, and these decisions are simply imposed on their other members as well as their followers, right? That is what is happening in the internal functioning of a political party. But that should not be there, right? The decision should be broad based, and this should be consensually oriented. Okay, and most important concern should be increasing and improvement the quality of political participation by the ordinary citizens, right? So they should allow the room, enough room, so that the ordinary citizens should participate in the democratic functioning of a political party, right? And for that purpose, a political reform should be very important, right? But many political party, almost every political party, is resisting that reforms, right? So they should have the will power to implement that political reforms, not only outside but also within the political party also, right? Measures like, you know, democratic movements, citizens organizations, media are likely to succeed. But nowadays, you can also understood the media houses are captured by the political parties. They don't air, or they don't provide you the right or factual information, but they would provide you the wrong and distorted information, right? The media houses now are controlled by major political parties. They don't provide you right information. So that is the, again, limitation of the media houses, right? So these media houses, right, these citizenship organizations, right, they should be independently functioning, right? They should not be, you know, controlled by those political parties, right, for their own benefit, okay? So definitely all suggestions in the proposals about overcoming various challenges are called democratic reforms or the political reforms that we are talking all about, okay? Many such reforms have been proposed by the Election Commission of India, by the various, the committees which are set up by the government of India, but they were not accepted wholeheartedly by the government of India or by the political party. They were resisted by the political party, by the different factions of the political party. All right. So those challenges should be taken, right? And we should also move for the political reforms, right? We should develop some proposals to the reforms at a national level, but the real challenges may find at the national level. May not find at the national level, but real challenge may find at the state level or even the local level. So we should identify all the challenges which are finding, right? And then based on the consensus, right, we should able to have those reforms, right, at every level, at the national level, at the state level, at the political level, at the grassroots level. We should able to resolve all the challenges one by one, and we need the willpower from the political parties, because without their support we cannot implement those reforms. So political parties should be proactively support in this reform, then only we will be able to reform our democratic functioning of the government. So there are different ways and the means for the political reforms in India. So first of all, we can think of the legal ways of reforming the politics, right? So that is that we can bring the new laws, right? But how many laws will you bring, right? That is to bring undesirable changes, right? So that temptation need to be registered. Rather, we should be open to reforming our political system, right? So any legal challenge must be carefully looked, right? And we will have to move very carefully, otherwise it may be counterproductive over the period of the time, right? And the democratic reform, what we are aspiring, should be based on the political practice, right? So it should be based on the political practice, and the political party should first focus on the political reforms to strengthen the democratic functioning of their own political functioning, than to the outside, you know, also, right? So in that situation, right, we should be able to implement, right, those reforms which are consensusly oriented and which are, you know, willingly adopted by those political parties. That should be a good solution for the longer run. So in the redefining democracy, what we can understood in the sense is the rulers here, I told you the rulers means the representatives. You must always understand the representatives, they should be elected by the people, right? And people should take all the decisions in the redefining democracy, right? These rulers or these representatives should not be, you know, elected, you know, based on some sort of a haphazard or some sort of a irrational criteria. And elections will be there, that is, regular elections will be there. These elections are free and fair, that will provide a greater number of choice to the greater number of the people, that should provide a fair opportunity to every section of the society, right? And the choices and the opportunities should be available to all sections of the society. Okay, then only the people can pursue their own dreams and goals and aspirations in the life. And that should be based on the equality, that should be based on the harmony, and that should not be based on the religion, caste, sex, place of birth, and other criteria, right? And the existence of the choice must lead to the government, right? And you must also understand the choices should be there to the people to lead their life as they want, right? And it should be based on the rational criteria, rather than it should be based on some other irrational criteria for that purpose. All right, so that basically we can redefine our democracy in that way. All right, so thank you very much for today's lecture. We have completed this book, right? And please take care of yourself because of corona, and we will certainly meet tomorrow for our next lecture. So take care of yourself. Thank you very much, those who attend this session. Thank you.